thank the Lord for the grace that he has given us to witness today and to be here for this training. At this point, I'll call upon the chairman of the Education and Training Steering Committee, in person of Superior Evangelist Michael Aishida, to give us his
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Our Lord Jesus Christ is the chairman of today. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Well, brethren, on behalf of the Education and Steering Committee of the Diocese, I welcome you all to this occasion in the name of our Father Jehovah and His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. This committee has mapped out an expansive and incisive programs for members of this diocese in general and for the shepherds and church workers in particular. Our programs will be A, growth oriented, B, sustainability of Celestial Church Christ core values and tenets, and C, personal academic development of individual members. Today, our subject matter is GDPR. Please grant me your indulgence to give my own mundane interpretation of GDPR. This is legal control over access to facts stored on devices, for instance, computers. Data, I believe, means facts, figures, information which can be classified, stored, or retrieved from storage, or from devices, or from computer. Now, the largest or the biggest and the highest master of GDPR, would you know that is our Almighty God, who created heaven and earth, light and darkness, day and night, sun and moon, etc. All these creations follow each other in such unchangeable succession, according to the Bible we have read in Genesis. You see, Baba God has got a computer. The computer is so well protected and locked up without any legal access by anybody except him and Christ Jesus, who both have the relevant key and password. If we want to stretch this further, I wish to refer you to the book of Solomon, Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, where we read from verse 1 to 8. But I'll just give an example of it. Says there is a time for everything under the sun. And a particular example is a time to be born and a time to die. These two times, nobody knows except him, Baba God. And the times are locked up in his GDPR device. Call it his telephone, call it his laptop, call it his computer, whatever. This is absolutely locked up in Baba God's GDPR computer. That is why he is called the Alpha and the Omega, who knows the end from the beginning. And in fact, we say that before the world is created, he has already chosen and he knows who and who is to be present here today. Such number and such persons are locked up in his computer and we don't know it until today. If you get what I mean. And such things, because he knows the end from the beginning, you can call these things the unsearchable mysteries of God. Well, brethren, my simple task is not at the moment is not to bore you down with any inspirational address, but to channel all of us to the keen awareness of GDPR as an instrumentality of pastoral ministry, as also employed by God Himself. This can be very useful in preaching, in writing, leadership responsibilities, and very importantly, as an insight to shepherds who face challenges, conflicts, even congregational crisis as it is of today. Finally, let me wrap things up and say to you that the proof of the pudding is in the eating, which will today be proved that that pudding will be provided today by a professional consultant who is Mr. Ram, to whom I commend you all.
Thank you very much.
And from that speech, we can see that, yes, we're on the way to achieving our goals. The goals have been set, and I know that with God, we definitely will achieve them. Amen. Without wasting much of our time, it is now 11:48, we'll make it 11:50, and I'll call upon our lecturer who has been introduced to you. He's a consultant and a specialist in this field, in person of Mr. Ram Kunnani.
There's one, an opportunity to be with all of you. Are you able to hear me at the end?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Let me first give a little bit of information about myself and Rizwan. We work together as a team, and we offer services around GDPR and also around the digital transformation. Digital transformation, again, is a very wide subject which we will not touch upon today, but we will touch upon GDPR. Now, to begin with, I would like to know, what do you know about GDPR as of today? What do you know about GDPR? Anyone?
It's the European law, right?
Yes.
We know much about that. It's the data protection by passed by the European Parliament.
Yeah. That's true. So GDPR is basically General Data Protection Regulation, and I'll go in detail about that. That's the whole purpose of this session today. And I'll be covering all these different areas. What is GDPR? Why GDPR? Who is GDPR for? It's also the which departments require GDPR compliance? GDPR principles. GDPR practical approach, GDPR roadmap, and impact for an organization being GDPR non-compliant. Okay, so it's a lot of material. We'll try and cover up as quickly as possible. And you will get the presentation copy and also the GDPR principles as described by the government in United Kingdom. You can use those principles wherever you are, not necessarily for this organization, but they are universal. So let us start with what is GDPR. It is an opportunity to gain, maintain, and enhance customer trust, interaction, and future business. Now, future business is a very generic term. For a spiritual organization like this, it's building trust with the devotees, building trust with the different organizations that the spiritual organization has been working with, and amongst the committee members who interact with each other. But it's an opportunity to gain, maintain, and enhance customer trust, interaction and future business. And that is all about GDPR. This GDPR was passed by the European Union in 2016, and they gave time up until 25th of May 2018 for all the organizations across the European Union to gear up, and also the organizations which have the presence outside of European Union, but they are having the personal data of the European Union citizens. Okay, and this particular law, or GDPR, is applicable not only within European Union, but it is across the world, wherever the personal data of a European Union citizen is being recorded. So let us take, for example, somebody goes to Nigeria or Kenya and is British citizen, stays in the hotel. So obviously the personal data is shared there. Now this hotel needs to be GDPR compliant, because if the personal data of the UK citizen is leaked from there, the UK citizen has the right to take action against that hotel. Okay. So it's across the world, wherever there is a personal data of European Union citizen being held, GDPR is applicable. Now what is GDPR? It is the European Union regulation which replaced Data Protection Act 1998 on 25th of May 2018. Are you familiar with the Data Protection Act of 1998? Are you familiar with the Data Protection Act of 1998? So it prevailed for nearly 20 years, and then GDPR has taken over. It's applicable to personally identifiable data of EU citizens alive. Okay, this is very important part, that the personal data of every living being, every human being within the EU citizenship, this law is applicable. Okay, now, what is personally identifiable data? Okay. Suppose you know my name by now, Ram Kundanani. Can you identify me with just name Ram Kundanani? Can you tell me whether you can identify me if somebody tells you Ram Kundanani?
No,
you are right. Because that's only one parameter. Okay? But the moment I say Ram Kundanani, an email address becomes more precise. With that you can. If I say Ram Kundanani and mobile number, you can identify it. Ram Kundanani or the person's name and address, you can identify. Person's name and a photograph, you can identify. So any two parameters, when you put together of a person who is alive, then that person can be identified. And that is the meaning of personally identifiable data. And this personally identifiable data can be anything and everything. Your health records and your name is personally identifiable data. Your bank details, be it credit cards, debit cards, charge cards, all that along with your name, is you can be identifiable. So the scope is quite wide, and with Data Protection Act of 1998, it was fairly limited. Okay, that encompasses much wider scope of personal data. That's what I just explained to you. there are new roles introduced, which is the controller, processor, and data protection officer. Let me explain to you what these roles are. Now, controller is the data owner, personal data owner. That's the controller. Then a processor is an organization which is processing the personal data. And the data protection officer is the person who has the responsibility to ensure that all the principles of GDPR are being followed through, and also to interact with ICO, that's Information Commissioner's Office, the government body which regulates GDPR, in case of data breach. Okay, so the responsibility of data protection officer is fairly heavy. One, it is the governance related. Second, it is with reference to interaction with the Information Commissioner's Office. And third, it is to ensure that the investigation of the data breach is being conducted as described by ICO, that's Information Commissioner's Office. It gives much greater rights to data subjects. Now, every person from GDPR perspective is considered as a data subject. So it has got much greater rights to data subjects. To name few, I will not go in detail, I'll be going in detail subsequently, is your data access rights, your data deletion rights, data retention rights, data modification rights, and so on and so forth. So the scope of the rights have increased significantly for data subjects. There are increased penalties. In the Data Protection Act of 1998, let us say that whole of National Health Services record, NHS records, are all stolen. The maximum penalty that ICO could charge was £500,000. And that has increased to €20 million or 4% of global revenue. Not profit, but global revenue. And that's a lot. So let us consider that this particular church is within the umbrella of celestial church of Jesus Christ, and it's a global organization. Now there is a data breach happening in London. But when the ICO will start evaluating or start investigating the data breach, they will not consider what is the money coming into this particular premises, but global premises. And that penalty can be €20 million or 4% of global revenue, whichever is higher. And that is why every organization, small or large, has become very, very cautious about GDPR. Because as per GDPR, a small organization like a beauty parlor, hair salon, or shopkeepers, everybody is covered. It's not only the spiritual organizations of this size or the large multinational corporations or the banks or small to medium-sized companies. No, it's across the organizations. It's applicable. And governance is very, very stringent. For example, in the Data Protection Act 1998, a data breach took place today. And I would not disclose it to anyone. Okay, I will keep quiet. If there is a data breach by a car parking company, then they have a different association. And their guidelines say you need to inform all the citizen data subjects whose data is at potential breach within 24 hours. So that is not even 72 hours, that is 24 hours. The similar guidelines are there from each industry sector to industry sector, and that's become more prominent with reference to GDPR. And if, again, these guidelines are not followed through, then there is, again, implication from ICO. So the governance has become very, very stringent. And I'll use some of the examples about the reasons what has happened in the past. How many of you recollect the Uber case? How many of you are aware of the data leak from Uber? Okay, it's in public domain. Okay, it was in the media for a very long time. The driver details, are you familiar with Uber? Uber service? Okay. So within the Uber, there are two prominent categories of personal data. One is the drivers, second is the passengers. Okay. Now there is a data breach in the United States of large volume, some 50 million number they have given. And so 50 million people's data records were impacted. And some company contacted them that, yes, we have your data. And there are two choices. Either we misuse the data or you pay us the money that you want. And they settled it with the company. 2.5 years later, the company which has stolen the data, they went to India. And they said, we did this. At that point, Uber accepted. They said, yes, this is what happened. This is how we have settled. And we never informed any of the government bodies about this data breach. That's a very wrong thing to happen. And then the matter went to the court in the United States and also in the United Kingdom, because the data of a lot of United Kingdom citizens also was at stake. And then they had to pay some penalty. But again, the limit was half a million. There was a data breach from TalkTalk, and they were impacted as well. And all the people were offered some kind of all the customers were offered some kind of concessions as a result of data breach. Let me give you another example of British Airways, and that data breach happened post 25th of May 2018. And again, the data was lost for a fairly large number of people. They said, okay, we will offer you a free service to the agencies which monitor our credit rating for 1 year. To all the impacted people, there was one thing that they did. Second, they were also penalized by ICO for the data breach. So that's the difference. And when this time the data breach happened and the penalties were imposed on them, were fairly high. You might have heard about the penalties being imposed on organizations like Google post 25th of May 2018, and also for Facebook for the data breaches which have happened with them post 25th of May 2018. So these things are becoming very, very prominent, very, very crucial for the businesses and the organizations to understand different patterns and the behaviors. But we will not touch upon those today. But the basic thing is the way the data was being captured in 1998 and the way it is being captured now and the way it will be captured in the future is changing very fast, and therefore it's important to have some regulation in place to protect the personal data and the personal rights. Any questions?
Thank you. I wish it was a 4 million IoT.
Sorry?
IoT.
Internet of Things.
Internet of Things.
Things. T-H-I-N-G-S. Things. Sorry?
The car park.
Yes.
So you are coming out from the exit of car park.
Yes.
Some car, they will go free. Some will be waiting for you.
Well, they have something called number plate recognition technology. And the camera picks up your number and it is connected with their system. The moment you make the payment, it reconciles with that. But if you have not made the payment, then that based on the picture, in time and out time, they can charge you. Now, who is it for? Can I have the slides?
I can give you some more example of IoT. Like you can control your heating from your mobile. And you can control a dryer machine or these type of things, fridge. So these things you can do through the mobile. So that was just because that devices you're using through the internet with your computer. So this is another example.
I will share with you another example. If you go to some of the hotels, they have a refrigerator. And they say we have sensors installed. Now suppose a person picks up a drink from the refrigerator and replaces it after 3 hours because the amount being charged by the hotel is very high as compared to that in the supermarket. So a person will go and buy the same drink from the supermarket and replace it there. But that hotel will still charge you because they know that nobody will pick up a drink from the refrigerator and keep it somewhere else for such a long time. So that sensor gives them that indication. That IoT device gives them that indication. Another example. Suppose you have the refrigerator connected with a particular supermarket. Okay? And you keep your bottle of milk at a particular spot. Now this IoT device will keep track of the weight of that bottle. When it comes to very low level as you would have prescribed, then it will send, it will give message to the neighboring supermarket that yes, the milk is coming to an end, please keep it ready, you'll come and tell. And you get the message that yes, your milk is ready for collection. But these all things are going to happen in the future. They are under development. Now, who is it for? Okay. I touched upon it before, but this is the corporate organization. Then you have the micro, small, and medium-sized organizations. Micro organizations are barbers of the world, or beauticians, or grocery shops. Okay. Then you have the small to medium-sized companies, which are defined as the organizations with less than 250 employees, as small to medium-sized organizations. Then you have the education sector, right from nursery to university level. Okay. And as I was explaining to you before, every sector has different guidelines for retaining the personal data. I'll give an example of nursery. Can you tell me at what age a child starts going to nursery?
Three.
Or 2 years? 2 to 3 years, right? And at what age a child leaves nursery?
Five,
6. Yeah, and then they move to preschool or they. Now, can you tell me if a child left a nursery, either to move to the school or changes the nursery from A to B, how long do you think the nursery must maintain the record of that child? Sorry? Sorry?
6 years.
6 years. Okay. Anybody else? Sorry? 3 years. Okay. Anybody else?
5 years.
5 years. They need to store or retain the data of that child up until the child turns 25 years of age. Up until 25 years. That's a long period. But that's the responsibility that all the nurses have. All the schools have. A child might leave the school after, say, completing A levels, but still the same school needs to retain the record of that child until that child becomes 25 years old. It's applicable to nurseries, to universities. Let's talk about health sector. Okay, again, two scenarios that the personal data is important there. One, when a person switches from one GP surgery or one hospital or one dentist to another. Okay, and the second scenario is once a person would complete the journey on this earth planet and moves on beyond. Now, in either case, what is the duration for which an organization needs to retain the data? It is 30 years. 30.
30.
30. Okay. If it is commercial organization, corporations, okay, the day you stop transacting with them, okay, then it is 6 years. Let us say that you have you are an employee of an organization. Okay, so you finish your contract, move on. So the organization is expected to retain the data for maximum 6 years. You purchase something from a shop, your personal data is retained by them. But from today's date, you are not buying anything from them. They need to maintain that record for 6 years. You, or those who are doing business, would know that you need to retain your financial records. Again, there the limit is 6 years. Charity sector is again very important, like yourself. You need to maintain the record either 6 years or as decided by the organization. But again, for charity sector, the body governing is charity commission. The charity commission is the governing body for all the charities across the United Kingdom. Okay. So it's applicable to the smallest possible organization to the biggest possible organization.
Is it a general rule or confined to a specific organization?
I will tell you. See, there are two parts to the personal data retention. One is the legal requirement. Okay. The second is the sector requirement. Okay. Now, the legal requirement is largely to do with the commercial transactions, which is 6 years. So all the financial records of the businesses are retained for 6 years. The second is the sector information, and that varies from sector to sector. And I share with you different examples from nursery to the health sector, the financial transactions. Suppose I purchase something using my debit card or credit card. The company which has collected my payment is expected to retain that data for 6 years from today. Okay? So that's a legal requirement. Okay? So it depends on the scenario. Okay? Is that clear? Thank you. Now, which department is GDPR applicable? It's almost every department of an organization. I'm not saying just commercial, but any organization, every department is impacted with GDPR. Let's start with marketing, online and offline. Today, can I ask you, what are the different ways that you all have been using to communicate with the devotees? Emails, leaflets, and post. So that those are all the different ways that you are communicating. Communication is largely to do with marketing. You are collecting information from devotees. Suppose you are participating in an exhibition. So participation in exhibition is a marketing activity. There you say, hey, our church offers these all different services. Would you be interested? And I come to your store, I say, yes, I am interested in it. And I am interested to collect more information from you regularly. Then what is the next step that you take? You say, hey, why don't you do your name, number, and address? So that's collection of personal data. Isn't it? So it's online and offline. I go to your website. I see that you are hiring rooms for organizing events. Okay? I get interested because most of the people who are attending my event are located nearby. So what do I do? Go into your website, fill in the form, and that form comes to you. But while I'm doing that, what is happening? I'm sharing my personal data with all of you, or with that website. So there are a number of different ways that the online and offline marketing is taking place, and everywhere the personal data is being collected, that is to be maintained. Business. Any transactions that we do, either we buy or we sell, but there is personal data being transacted there. Finance. Be it the accounting systems that we use, again we are using personal data there. Then sales. We collect so much of data. Somebody is giving donation to an organization. So what are we doing? That's in a way sale for that particular organization. And that donation money, when it is being collected, personal data is being collected. It's not only the name and address. Again, we ask, would you like to receive some more communication from us in future? And that's marketing element coming alongside sales. So we say is important. Human resources. We collect so much of data when an employee is joining or a volunteer is joining a spiritual organization. And then that whole sets of data need to be maintained. Okay? So if you look at any organization, all the different departments that they may have, the personal data is being collected and therefore this is important. Okay? Any questions? Now, next is the principles. I want to ask you. Are the principles ready?
Yes.
Are they ready?
Everyone's got
the principles.
I think we will provide that email address and address the church address.
Yeah? So you all have the copy of the presentation which I am using, and also the 12 principles which you see here are narrated in this document. Have all of you received this now? Please do not complete the consent form now. First, I need to explain to you in that consent form, so please don't complete it now. Please don't fill the consent form now. I will explain to you, and then you can complete it. So, have you all received this document now?
Yes.
Now, this is the document published by Information Commissioner's Office. You'll see at the bottom. Information Commissioner's Office, ICO. And ICO is the governing body of GDPR in the United Kingdom. They published this guide, a brief guide, before 25th of May 2018 to help the organizations prepare themselves. Okay? But all the principles were valid then, they are valid today, and they will be valid in the future. So the principles will remain the same. Okay? And I'm going to cover one after the other, and you can refer to the respective principles in this talk. The first is awareness. And what is meant by awareness is to help the data subjects, be it an employee, be it volunteer, be it senior management, be it committee members of the spiritual organizations, get acquainted with what is GDPR. Because until you understand what is GDPR and its implications, you will not be able to appreciate the significance of it, and therefore you will not be able to follow it in its true sense. So the first aspect is awareness, and how this is being done is by means of trainings like this. Before 25th of May 2018, in the organizations, especially the commercial organizations, they used to have the training for different levels of because the amount of data that the senior management, say managing director or the board of director level people will have access to will be completely different from the ones at the operational level. And the implications of GDPR would be different as well. For example, if there's a data breach in a multinational company, the people responsible for the data breach are the senior management. Although there is a data protection officer who has the responsibility within the organization, but the accountability ultimately remains with the senior management. Because they are the ones who are the leaders in that organization, and they have the responsibility, final responsibility, to ensure that the personal data is kept secure. So there used to be training sessions for the senior management, the middle management, the operational level management, people from every department will have the training. There was one organization where I was associated. There are 450 employees across the United Kingdom. And I was asked to train each one of them with 1 hour session each. And the way it was to be done was specific to that department. So some aspects will be common to all, but rest will be specific to HR, for example, or for sales and marketing, for example, or for the support team, for example. So every department was to be trained, and it required a lot of thinking and was completed on time. Okay, So what I'm trying to say is the first aspect is the awareness. And that's the principle explained here, that every person must be aware. And second is the information you hold. You should know yourself as to what kind of information you are holding about the person. In order to help you, now you can refer to your consent form, okay? And you can see what is the information being collected. Can you tell me, after looking at the consent form, whether your organization needs any personal information other than what is listed there? Can you please check and tell me this? In the consent form, it's a two-page document, everybody has been given. Yeah, it's a single sheet. Yeah. This is designed for you. Yeah. Okay. Those who have it, can you please tell me whether your organization needs any more personal data than what it is listed here? The name, address line 1, address line 2, address line 3, your city and county, postcode, landline number, mobile number, and email address. Do you need anything other than this for your activity purpose? This is sufficient, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. So, what ICO is saying is you should collect the personal data of the data subjects to the extent you require it. Okay. For, again, with reference to this organization, do you think you will require the bank account details? No. Isn't it? So, no need. So the information required for the purpose of this organization is this much only. Okay. Now, let us consider, let me explain to you about the personal data little in depth. There are two types of personal data. One, it is standard data. Okay. Second, it is enhanced data or sensitive data. Now, whatever information you read in this consent form is a standard data. Suppose somebody's address is lost. Okay, there's a data breach and the devotees' addresses are lost. What is the financial impact on the data subject if the address is lost? Hardly any. Worst case, what will happen? Some people will knock the door. Okay. But will it seriously harm a person? Not really. But look at the other part, which is sensitive data. All your health records, all your financial records, they are sensitive data. And whenever there is a breach of the sensitive data, there is a greater impact on the data subjects and also for the organizations from where it has been lost. So, then there are other parts, for example, the equal opportunity information that you share with the organization. Although most of the organizations will say it's only for our statistical purpose. But everything that you are listing there is your sensitive data. That must not be leaked. There are two types of data. One is the personal data. Sorry, one is the standard data and the enhanced data. The enhanced data loss is more severe in nature as compared to the standard. So the information you hold, so the principle is that, sorry, your question?
Yeah, the information is here.
Yeah.
Is there any difference between the bank data and this standard?
Okay. See, in the bank, there are two pieces of information. Okay. One is information, something of this kind. The second, it is your bank account details, your bank account number, your sort code, then your transactions. Now those things become more serious. Suppose, I come to know about your bank account details, okay? There is a possibility that I may misuse it. And let me give you another piece of information, share with you a piece of information. In 1995, or around that time, the personal data theft was in its infancy. And it started off in early 90s from United Kingdom. In those days, there are more of the credit cards which were swiped. You know, you put a paper and then you swipe. It will have the image of the credit card, then you sign and the payment is corrected. So, there are companies which used to collect the credit card numbers of this kind in large volumes and then sell them. For selling one such record, the credit card number, both sides, including your security code, three-digit security code of the back of the card, they used to get $200 for one card. And if they would sell it in millions, you can imagine what kind of money they were making. And today, those numbers have come down to as low as $1. But then the sophistication of stealing the data has changed as well. So you can imagine, if merely this kind of information is stolen from the bank or the financial institution, vis-a-vis your credit card and debit card number, where people are more likely to damage you. There have been instances which I can share with you. One example I will share with you is how people misuse the cards. Okay. One day, a friend of mine went to a counter of a supermarket, made the payment, and from supermarket from the till went to the entrance, went out to the cash machine, and realized, where is my card? So went back inside and started inquiring here and there. Went to security and inquired about the card. Security said, "Is this your card?" And he said, "Yes, that's my card." Security gave the card. Person went happily home. After 3 hours, received a call from the credit card company. Say, "Have you made any transactions in the last 5 minutes?" And he said, "No." One transition which is unusual to your transition pattern has happened already, which is for £29. The second transition is currently being done for £450, and that's where we suspected a potential issue, potential risk, we are calling. And because you are confirming now, we understand what has happened to you, we are cancelling your card with immediate effect, and we send you another card. Now, I'm just giving an example as to if merely this kind of information is being breached vis-a-vis the actual card is being lost, what kind of impact can it have? And let me tell you, the banks, credit card companies are very, very sensitive to unusual transactions. Okay? A friend of mine went to Canada. And he was traveling on a train, paid for a cup of tea, $1.30. which is less than a pound. And his credit card company blocked the car. Because what they saw was a train company. How can the transaction be less than a pound? They have all that those details as to what kind of organizations are there. Okay. But the moment they saw something suspicious, they blocked it. The person called from Canada, it's my transaction approved. So I'm just trying to explain to you the severity of the loss of sensitive data. Yeah.
Again, it is, if you are giving your consent to the bank,
yeah,
includes approving all these to you, you
yes.
say ask for your DOB.
Sorry?
You say as you ask for your DOB.
And
the bank.
Okay. If it is a bank or any other organization, they will ask you for consent more for marketing purposes. Okay. When I will cover consent, I'll explain to you a little more on that. There are different kinds of consents, okay, but I'll cover more at that point. But the consents which normally the banks will take from you is more for the marketing purposes. How you want to communicate it right now. So, communicating privacy information. This is again, I have covered the information you hold or the organization holds. Any questions on that part? That's more. Third is communicating privacy information. Okay. Now, this used to be very vague in the past, but today it is more specific. Every website that you visit will have a privacy policy. And with the privacy policy will be a button, I agree. Or will have the options of my preferences. There is everything to do with your privacy. And earlier it was implied. Today it is not implied. Is with the data subject. So the privacy, how that is communicated is changed as you can. Okay. Let's move to the next one. Individuals' rights. It's a fourth principle in the page number 4. So this is very, very important. And completely different from the Data Protection Act of 1998. Sir, I'm referring to this document, page number 4. Okay. So, right to be informed is the first right of the data subject. There is a question about the data retention, which will be covered here. Okay. So, data to be informed, so the right to be informed, this is to do with your communication. How do you like the organization to communicate to you? The second is the right of access. There's a question around right of access. And what this means is a data subject has the right to ask an organization to share what personal data the organization is holding for that person. Okay. For example, 6 months down the line, when you have more of these forms, or let's say 5 years down the line, a person thinks, hey, I had submitted a form in the past, but how much data do you think they will be holding about me? So at that point, the person has a right inquire with this organization to what personal data they have for this particular subject. Okay. And that's the right of access. And this has changed in the sense, as per the old system of Data Protection Act 1998, there, but it said that once a person is submitting a request, then within 40 days, the organization is expected to respond with the answer. Now that is reduced to 30 days. Second, in the past, there was a £10 fee for collecting such information. So it used to be an additional revenue in a way to cover up at least the cost of offering that service. But now that £10 is gone, if it is a genuine request, but the organization make that decision if it's a genuine or it is persistent, the same request coming from the same data subject again and again. If it is non-genuine, then the organization can decide how much they want to charge. Okay? But this is the right of access changed now. Next one is right to rectification. Okay? So this says that suppose I have changed the address. In the past, it used to be very complicated to change the address. Now, by law, if the request has come through, not only of address, but of changing any parameter, then the action is to be prompt and the organization is to respond back with the answer. Okay. Right to erasure. Okay. Suppose you have given the consent today and after 10 months you think that, hey, I don't want to receive the postal information. So you can ask for erasure there. You can ask for completely deleting your record. That's the right of erasure. Then a right to restrictive processing. Now this is applicable if an organization is using multiple processors or is offering multiple services to the individuals of the data subjects. And the data subject can define as to what areas they want their data to be shared with other people. Okay. There's a portability. Many times you have read in the media that the CD was sent by one of the government departments with personal data, and that CD did not reach the other destination. So there is a problem with data portability. That the data was on a CD, that CD did not reach that destination. So now within the data portability part, the organizations have greater responsibility to ensure that if the data is moving from A to B within the premises or between the premises, then that needs to be absolutely secure in order to avoid data breaches. Then right to object, the data subjects or every individual has the right to object the way the communication is happening with them if it is not followed through as per their instructions. If it is happening as per their instructions, they can request for a change, but they can't object. The next one is right not to be subject to automated decision making, including profiling. This is a bit complex, let's not touch upon that matter. And while evaluating all these things, we should be looking at the data protection assessment, whether what is the risk involved while exercising each of these areas. I'll give you an example. Okay. Your bank account number, your source code, then your transactions. Now those things become more serious. Suppose I come to know about your bank account details. Okay? There is a possibility that I may misuse it. And let me give you another piece of information, share with you a piece of information. In 1995, or around that time, the personal data theft was in its infancy. And it started off in early 90s from United Kingdom. In those days, there are more of the credit cards which were swiped. You know, you put a paper and then you swipe, it will have the image of the credit card, then you sign and the payment is corrected. So there are companies which used to collect the credit card numbers of this kind in large volumes and then sell them. For selling one such record, the credit card number, both sides, including your security code, three-digit security code of the back of the card, they used to get $200 for one card. And if they would sell it in millions, you can imagine what kind of money they were making. And today, those numbers have come down to as low as $1. But then the sophistication of stealing the data has changed as well. So you can imagine, if merely this kind of information is stolen from the bank or the financial institution, vis-a-vis your credit card and debit card number, where people are more likely to damage you. There have been instances which I can share with you. One example I will share with you is how people misuse the cards. Okay. One day, a friend of mine went to a counter of a supermarket, made the payment, and from the till, went to the entrance, went out to the cash machine, and realized, where is my card? So went back inside and started inquiring here and there, went to security and inquired about the card. Security said, is this your card? And he said, yes, that's my card. Security gave the card, person went happily home. After 3 hours, received a call from the credit card company. Said, have you made any transactions in the last 5 minutes? And he said, no. He said, one transaction which is unusual to your transaction pattern has happened already, which is for £29. The second transaction is currently being done for £450, and that's where we suspected a potential issue, potential risk, we are calling. And because you are confirming now, we understand what has happened to you, we are cancelling your card with immediate effect, and we'll send you another card. Now, I'm just giving you an example as to if merely this kind of information is being priest vis-a-vis the actual card is being lost, what kind of impact can it have? And let me tell you, the banks, credit card companies are very, very sensitive to unusual transactions. Okay? A friend of mine went to Canada and he was traveling on a train, paid for a cup of tea, $1.30, which is less than a pound. And his credit card company blocked the card. Because what they saw was a train company. How can the transaction be less than a pound? They have all that those details as to what kind of organizations are there. Okay. But the moment they saw something suspicious, they blocked. The person called from Canada, it's my transaction approved. So I'm just trying to explain to you the severity of the loss of sensitive data.
Yeah. Again, it is, if you are giving your consent to the bank,
yeah,
including all these things, do you say ask for your DOB?
Sorry?
Do you say as you ask for your DOB?
They
in the bank.
Okay. If it is a bank or any other organization, they will ask you for consent more for marketing purposes. Okay. When I will cover consent, I'll explain to you a little more on that. There are different kinds of consents, okay, but I'll cover more at that point. But the consents which normally the banks will take from you is more for the marketing purposes. How you want to communicate it back. So communicating privacy information. This is again, so I have covered the information you hold or the organization holds. Any questions on that part? Let's move on. Third is communicating privacy information. Okay. Now, this used to be very vague in the past, but today it is more specific. Every website that you visit will have a privacy policy. And with the privacy policy will be a button, I agree, or will have the options of my preferences. There is everything to do with your privacy. And earlier it was implied. Today it is not implied. It is with the data subject. So the privacy, how that is communicated, is changed as you do. Okay. Let's move on to the next one. Individuals' rights. It's a fourth principle in the page number four. So this is very, very important and completely different from the Data Protection Act of 1990. Sir, I am referring to this document, page number four. So, right to be informed is the first right of the data subject. There is a question about the data retention, which will be covered here. Okay. So, data to be informed, so the right to be informed, this is to do with your communication. How do you like the organization to communicate to you? The second is the right of access. There's a question around right of access. And what this means is a data subject has the right to ask an organization to share what personal data the organization is holding for that person. Okay? For example, 6 months down the line, when you have more of these forms, or let's say 5 years down the line, a person thinks, hey, I had submitted a form in the past, but how much data do you think they will be holding about me? So at that point, the person has a right to inquire with this organization to what personal data they have for this particular subject. Okay? And that's the right of access. And this has changed in the sense as per the old system of Data Protection Act 1998, it was there, but it said that once a person is submitting a request, then within 40 days, the organization is expected to respond with the answer. Now that is reduced to 30 days. Second, in the past, there was a £10 fee for collecting such information. So it used to be an additional revenue in a way to cover up at least the cost of offering that service. But now that 10 pounds is gone, if it is a genuine request, but the organization make that decision if it's genuine or it is persistent, the same request coming from the same data subject again and again. If it is non-genuine, then the organization can decide how much they want to charge. Okay. But this is the right of access changes now. Next one is the right to rectification. Okay. So this says that suppose I've changed the address. In the past, it used to be very complicated to change the address. Now, by law, if the request has come through, not only of address, but of changing any parameter, then the action is to be prompt and the organization is to respond back with the answer. Right to erasure. Okay. Suppose you have given the consent today and after 10 months you think that, hey, I don't want to receive the postal information. So you can ask for erasure there. You can ask for completely deleting your record. That's the right of erasure. Then right to restrictive processing. Now this is applicable if an organization is using multiple processors or is offering multiple services to the individuals or to data subjects. Then the data subject can define as to what areas they want their data to be shared with other people. Okay. Data portability. Many times you have read in the media that the CD was sent by one of the government departments with personal data, and that CD did not reach the other destination. So there is a problem with data portability. That the data was on a CD, that CD did not reach that. So now within the data portability part, organizations have greater responsibility to ensure that if the data is moving from A to B within the premises or between the premises, then that needs to be absolutely secure in order to avoid data breaches. Then right to object, the data subjects or every individual has the right to object the way the communication is happening with them if it is not followed through as per their instructions. If it is happening as per their instructions, they can request for a change, but they can't object. The next one is right not to be subject to automated decision making, including profiling. This is a bit complex, let's not touch upon that much. And while evaluating all these things, we should be looking at the data protection assessment, whether what is the risk involved while exercising each of these areas. I'll give you an example. Suppose there is a pending issue with a customer. And this customer comes to you with a complaint and it's all sorted to satisfaction of both sides on win-win basis. After 6 months, a person comes to you with a request for erasure, says, hey, now the problem is solved, can you delete all my data? My question is, will you do that? Will you do that? You should not do that. Because suppose you have deleted as per their request, that person is clever. He or she knows that my transactional data must be retained by the organization for 6 years from the date of my transaction date. Okay? I have created the dispute for this particular transaction, and after deletion of the data, person takes it to the court. What evidence will you have at that point? Nothing. And therefore, besides your initial settlement, you are more likely to end up on other settlement, which is not good. Okay? So a person may have the right for access, or a person may have right to delete, but then equally important it's for an organization to be decisive to what extent you want to honor that request. Okay? And to do that, every organization is expected to have certain sets of policies depending on their need. And then follow through that policy. Okay? Policies remain with the organization, people might change. Okay? And then follow the policy and respond to the people. Yeah. So what I was trying to explain to you was the data protection assessment. Okay. So this covers our part four, the fourth principle. Should we take a break now? Thank you.
Hallelujah. A round of applause for our audience. Thank you very much. I know there's been so much to take in. There's a lot of information, isn't it? And so at this point, we will go for our lunch break and we'll come back at 1:30. It's 15 minutes, but let's use that 15 minutes wisely, please. A few things provided for us there to have for lunch. Please, if you've not written your name down, or made your payment, please do so at the desk and write your name the same way you want us to put it on the certificate so that we can get your names right and get things done for you on time. Thanks very much, and we'll see you back here at 1:30.
Thank you.
The second round. But just before we go back to the lecture, I want to acknowledge the presence of our fathers in our midst. The HOD, the head of diocese of UK diocese, our father in the Lord, Venerable Superior Evangelist Prophet Dr. Amos Fatusi. Welcome, sir. God bless you, sir. Yes, sir. And his able deputy, the daddy of boys, Daddy Anewayinti, sir. The deputy head of diocese, I stand Venerable Superior Evangelist Bola Olaleye, that we all know as a want to communicate community or tea, one baba ala ketu.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Daddy, we welcome you. And we appreciate the fact that you've taken out of your busy schedule to be here. Because we learned that you traveled and you both just got back this morning. So it is an encouragement for us. If Baba that has traveled, got back this morning and he was still able to make it, I see no reason why we all should not be here. So we'll go on to the concluding part of the lecture for GDPR by Mr. Ram Kudnani. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So the first, how did you find the first part?
Okay.
Thank you. The second part, it's going to be a little more challenging for me rather than you. Because after having lunch, I need to ensure that you all are awake. Okay. But I'll try my best to keep you engaged. Okay. So the organization can refuse to provide the information that is being asked for, but will need to give the due justice. Similarly, if a person is asking for the same information again and again, either you can refuse to divulge that, or you can still share the information for charging that person. Okay. Then the next one is lawful basis for processing personal data. This is very, very important one. There must be a reason for an organization to collect the personal data, and also there must be a reason for an organization to process the personal data. Okay? And that must be lawfully binding. Okay? Let's consider again the church example. I signed the consent form. Okay? I signed the consent form to receive the communication from the church. So, what am I doing by giving the consent? What am I doing? Let me repeat the question. I signed this consent form. Suppose I sign this consent form to receive the communication from this church. What am I doing?
Right.
Correct. And that is the legal base, isn't it?
Yes.
That I have given my consent to this church to send me the communication in future. So that's a legal base. When we are buying something from a shop, what are we doing? We are legally binding ourselves, and the organization is binding itself with us for transacting that particular activity. It's a legal base. So GDPR says that whatever personal data you are collecting, there must be a legal reason behind it. There must be some kind of legal binding. And therefore, if you go online on any website today, which has relationship with the United Kingdom, will ask you for the privacy statement to be accepted by you before you start accessing certain sensitive parts of the website. So what are you doing? By agreeing to the privacy statement, you are legally binding yourself to that website. Okay? And one of the reasons why that is being done is the cookies policy. Can you tell me what are cookies?
Cookies are small snippets that you drop in the computer to track your operations or something.
Absolutely, absolutely. So it's a small piece of program which comes through to your computer from a website, and then that program tracks your activities. And how do the organizations use that activity? I'll give you an example. Suppose you want to book a flight to Nigeria. Let's take another example. Okay? So you go onto the website, and start filling the basic information, but you don't buy the ticket. Okay? After that, you go on to Sky website. What happens there? All the advertisements that you see on Sky will be with reference to your travel. You go on to booking.com. Okay? Then after that, whatever websites you visit, you will see only booking.com. And that happens because of the cookie, which has picked up the information from your computer and passed on those details to Sky. Hey, this person seems to be interested in booking.com, and therefore let's push advertisements on this line. Okay. So the cookies are very important part, and they take the permission from you to use the cookies by means of the privacy statement. If this organization has a website or has a global website, only one website, I would suggest you must change the privacy policy that appears on the website by amending it. You must change that to reflect GDPR. Okay. So there must be a legal basis for processing the personal data. Let's move on to the next one. Consent. Now consent, what is consent? Can you tell me what is consent? Absolutely correct, it's a permission. So consent is a permission. Now this permission needs to be from a data subject to an organization. Okay. Now this is a very important thing to understand. Suppose I, as Ram Kundanani, is meeting Mr. Michael, okay, just on the street, not for any business purpose, okay. We exchange information, and we leak information of each other. Can any action be taken against either of us, or can action be taken by either of us against each other? Answer is no. It's an individual. It's not with an organization. Whereas GDPR is about the organizations. So the consent is giving permission. Now the permission needs to be evidence-based. Again, very important thing to understand. If you see this form that's been given to you, does it have a signature? And why is there a signature? Sorry? That's the permission you are giving. That's an evidence that you are establishing. Okay? So the consent needs to be evidence-based. I shared with you an example of the privacy policy. The moment you accept the privacy policy online, what happens with the website at the other end? It picks up your IP address. Okay? And let me tell you what is IP address. The IP address is the internet phrase, or in very simple terms, it is the telephone number in terms of internet. We have the mobile numbers. In the front, it is Ram Kundanani, but behind that, ultimately, it is a number only. Okay. If you take landline number, it is a landline number of so-and-so person or so-and-so family, but ultimately, it is the number only. But with that number, the connection happens. Likewise, in case of internet, it is internet protocol, which is IP. And that is the telephone number equivalent. So everything that we have, our email address, for example, on the back, there is IP address. Okay? You take any website, is nothing but on the back IP address. Okay? So the moment you are giving the consent online, evidence is established by picking up your three parameters. One, the IP address. Second, the date. Third, the time. And fourth, whatever has been your response. If you say no, even that evidence is picked up with the same parameters. Okay. So now the consent itself can be online or paper-based. In order for this church to start understanding and appreciating the significance of GDPR and the consent, I have designed this form only for you. This is the extra piece of work which I volunteered to do. And I would request that all the members who are registered with the church must sign this consent form, either on paper or online. Okay? And then you should establish the database of your own of the people who have signed the consent form. You have the evidence in terms of the signatures and this document itself. It is difficult to have the paper-based storage for a long period, and therefore after taking the consent from the individual, I would suggest you should scan each document and store it adequately. Okay? So this is one action that you must do as an organization. And after that, whatever is the preference given by each devotee, you must follow those instructions. Whether they are given the consent for post or by email or by text or by phone. Based on my experience of dealing with the similar charitable organizations, I can tell you initially it may sound bit difficult and cumbersome task, but the organization save money because you establish an evidence from the consent form that very few people are interested to receive the communication by post today. But because we don't have that information available on hand now, we send by post as well. And what is the cost of the post vis-a-vis email? Significantly higher. You have the paper cost, then you have the envelope cost, then you have the postage cost. And if volunteers are doing that activity, it is fine. Otherwise, if some professional organization or professional individuals are doing, then there's a cost for that as well. But the moment you send an email, it's cheaper. It's quicker. The post takes, if you send a second class post, it can still take 3 to 4 days to reach, whereas emails reach instantly. So this is one activity which I would recommend strongly to the organization to start following straight away. There are two blanks in this form. On the first part, you need to put in the address where you want to receive the postal responses. And also you need to put in the email address where people should be sending this form to. Okay? Now, there can be different kinds of consents. Okay? One form of consent is just as this. Okay? The second kind of consent is legal consent. Suppose you meet with a, you do the again, taking the parking example, you go past the speeding camera at a much higher speed than what you should be going, and then you get a ticket. So, what is happening there? It's the legal consent that organization has from you. If you have breached their conditions, then they have right to issue you the ticket for legal. They would have posted in some way that you must not exceed certain speed limit. Or if you're going to car park, and you would have, they would have put in some legal text there, and you, the moment you enter, you are agreeing to those terms and conditions when you're parking there. And if you don't make the payment according to those conditions, then they have a legal consent from you to selling the penalty charges. So one is the legal, second is the transactional, third is of this kind. There are five different kinds of consents which the organizations can follow through, and sometimes the organizations take due advantage of it. The original example that I shared with you, where there used to be tick boxes already in, they were implicit consents. And what you see in this form, do you see any of these boxes? Are they ticked or unticked? They're unticked. Which means you as the data subject have the right to tick them and make a decision what you want to do. Whether you want to receive by post, whether you want to receive the communication by email, decide yourself. Which means I am taking the assertive and explicit consent from you. Okay? A specific example is mentioned by ICO in their own guidance notes. But they say, when you go to a doctor, GP, they'll refer you to somebody else, either to the hospital or to a consent. Okay. They'll take consent from you. They simply inform you. In GDPR terms, ICO says that is not allowed. They should ideally be taking your consent on piece of paper. Yes, you have given the consent to share your personal data, your health records with another organization. It is not happening. Let's understand this. And it's for the government to make a decision. But this is what the Information Commissioner's Office website says in the one of the guidance notes. So the different kinds of consent, which is important for us to understand. Then the children data. Okay. And what this means is, in the United Kingdom, until a child turns 16 years of age, the parental consent is required for anything and everything. Suppose a child is studying in a school, okay, and a photographs are taken, then it's the mandatory requirement under GDPR for the school or the education institute to take the consent of the parent whether those photographs should be published in any form, either on the website or even within the school or the nursery. So the current age is 16 years in the United Kingdom. The government is thinking about reducing it to 13 years, but when it happens, it happens. So current limit is 16 years. And let's move on to the next one.
Excuse me.
Sure.
Yeah, this consent in you here. Before the advent of the material from the mobile, with the telephone, we used to be, process whereby you are either ex-directly or indirectly,
yes,
for selling of your information. But today, what right have we got? Because now, once you have a mobile, your number is more or less sold everywhere. And this one will phone you, that one will phone you for sales. So what right have we got? Because now, we don't have the chance of saying it's ex-directly or it's indirectly.
It's no longer restricted. I'll explain to you.
Yeah.
In the past, when you were going for ex-directly,
yeah,
what were you doing? You are basically withdrawing your consent.
Exactly.
Okay? Now, ideally, under GDPR, an organization is expected to communicate to a data subject based on explicit and assertive consent many organizations. I can tell you about 9 months ago there was a report. It said 65% of the organizations in the United Kingdom are not GDPR compliant. Which means they are still using the data based on the implicit consent that people had given. Suppose you had purchased a flight ticket 10 years ago from a travel agent when there used to be the paper-based tickets, not email-based tickets, the paper-based tickets. And that company or that travel agent has been sending you emails since then, although you might not have purchased a single flight ticket in the last 10 years. That was an implicit consent they had taken at the time. Now, we all have done, including myself, given this kind of consent to many organizations in the past. Even today we are doing it. I'll explain to you how. How many of you go to any kinds of exhibitions? Any kind of exhibitions? I'm not saying trade exhibitions, any kind of exhibition. Now in exhibitions, what do you do? Or what do you experience? You go to a stall, you see something exciting, they'll put some gift there. Okay? And after giving you a pitch on what the service or the product they have, they'll say, can I give you this? A person is likely to accept it. But at the same time, what does it? Can I scan a badge?
Yes.
The moment they have scanned your badge means you have given your
consent.
So, although you have not given any information to that particular organization, but the moment they scan your badge, they get all the relevant details about you from the organizers. And therefore on, you start receiving telephone calls. You understand?
Yes.
So you see, we as data subjects also need to be a little careful as to where we are agreeing or not agreeing to sharing our personal data.
Mm-hmm.
And that's everything to do with consent. So on a number of occasions, we unconsciously give our personal data.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I'll give an example on, again, the consent part. Okay? Suppose I'm using my laptop here, okay, and accidentally, okay, I change the slide, not my presentation, but without realizing that you all are sitting here, I start doing financial transaction by logging into my account. I forget to disconnect my lid, which is connected with this whole system. What happens? I have given all of you consent to see what is there on the screen. Unconsciously. And that is where the whole of GDPR, which I'll be covering a little further in the presentation as well, is a security part. Be it physical security, be it IT security. Okay? So consent is very, very important. That's how I spent so much time on explaining to you. I hope you understood it now. Thank you.
Excuse me, please. So, based on the individual rights, the speech processing, how do you know if an organization is using multiple data? The first question. Then secondly, how do you restrict them from processing your data?
First part. Whether you have given the data once or multiple times, it ultimately depends on you. In case of doubt, you can ask the organization to provide you with that information. Okay? So that's the data access part of it. Okay? From the organization side of things, there are softwares available known as customer relationship management. this is basically the repository or database system of the customer data, personal data. Now suppose this church has collected details of Ram Kundanani once, and Ram Kundanani fills in this consent form and sends the information by post again. Now the person who is keying in the information does not know at that point in time whether my data is already there or not. But if that person starts keying in my information, the system, the customer relationship management system, tells that person it already exists. So it's two ways. One is at the individual level, second is at the organization. You can control. Sorry?
One is
individual level, that you yourself can check with the organization as to how many times your data has been collected. Now it can happen, and it's true to a larger extent, and now things are changing. You go to a bank, for example, open the current account. Few years down the line, you have mortgage account. Now, ideally, the bank should have the common database whereby they should be able to see all the relationship related to that particular person in one shot. But that does not happen. Or some of the banks now, they start changing, and therefore you see that difference happening. But in the past, it was not happening. So what happens is, the current account will send one communication. The mortgage will send another communication. If you have some other financial product from the same bank, will send a third communication. It will not come as one. And therefore, the marketing cost for the organizations used to be exorbitantly high because it was a duplication of efforts. But with the customer relationship management systems coming in, they now call something as the 360 degree view of a customer. What that means is, whatever is happening with that customer, the transactional data or any historical data that a person has, is in one place. But that's changing. Again, there the consents are important before they do anything. So we move on. Children, I just covered that 60, up to 16 years of age, the parental consent is required. Next one is data breaches. I covered this earlier on, that in case of data breaches, it's the responsibility of the person who finds out that there is a data breach and report it to two levels. One, the senior management, and second, the data protection officer. Then the data protection officer needs to conduct the initial assessment to establish whether the data breach has actually happened or not. And if the data breach has happened, then at a prima facie level, he or she needs to assess the severity of it and then report to the ICO for the data breach. And the investigation will take place, and it will be established towards severity, and the penalties will be decided. But it's not that easy, it takes time. Another thing which is very important from GDPR point of view for every organization is to register with ICO. Are you all registered with ICO now? If you are not, I would suggest please register with ICO at the earliest. Monday morning, please register with ICO. They charge £35 a day, until last day, which are £35 per year. And then register your details with them. And then all things of this kind, you can report to them, and they will take it. Okay. Data protection by design and data protection impact assessments. I will cover more in very brief, this is a very technical part, but I'll try to make it as simple as possible. So, to help you understand in easier way, suppose this spiritual organization is thinking of a new level of service, okay? And that service is not covered by this consent form, okay? Now, as per data protection by design, when you're thinking of the new service, you need to think through all the steps which are required to ensure that the personal data is going to be secure. That's personal protection, data protection by design. Okay. The next part is data protection impact assessment. Now this is applicable to any current project or current service or any future new service which any organization is going to introduce, for them to assess the risk of potential data breach. So this is basically assessing the risk for the current service or the new service. So data protection impact assessment is required under GDPR. So there are three scenarios given here on page number 8. One, where a new technology is being deployed, where a profiling operation is likely to significantly affect individuals, or where there is processing on a large scale of special categories. Data protection officers, I have covered this, so I will touch upon still. Data protection officer is the person who has multiple responsibilities. One responsibility is to ensure that all the principles of GDPR are being followed, okay? And to ensure that the personal data is safe and secure, is protected well. The second is to ensure that in case of data breach, they report to the ICO within 72 hours from the time they become aware, and to the other similar organizations impacting that particular sector. Okay? And then they need to interact with the ICO for the full impact analysis and whatever the penalties if they happen, and also take the ownership of the corrective actions being taken to prevent the future data losses, data breaches. Okay, that's the responsibility of data protection officers. And international. Now, international is, suppose a person is a UK citizen and is traveling to Australia, which is the other corner of the world, and there he or she is sharing the data. So the other country should also understand and acknowledge the data protection law of the United Kingdom, and therefore they should have adequate technological and operational measures to protect the personal data. And same thing is applicable for people coming from other countries into the United Kingdom, that their personal data, as per their privacy laws, should be maintained. Okay. So that covers the 12 principles that every organization is expected to follow. Even this organization will need to follow these principles. The first step has been taken today, which is this session. The second step is being taken today, the use of consent form. There are lots of other things to do, which I'll be following in my presentation. Yes, you had some questions.
Yes, the question I want to ask is about the ICO.
Yeah.
And you said to register within, you should get certified. Is it individual or?
It's organization.
Yeah.
It's organization. let us see whose personal data do we need to think about? Whose personal data we as an organization should be concerned? Or in other words, is the organization data protection, where is the connection? So you can see that the organization is at the center. In this particular instance, is this church. Okay? Now, how is church connected? So this church is connected with the government,
yeah.
With the local authority and police,
yes.
Connected with home office,
yes.
Connected with employers,
yeah.
Social media,
mm-hmm.
Associate partner or university organizations,
mm-hmm.
Customers, in case of this, the devotees, students, patients, passengers, etc. So devotees applicable here.
Yeah.
So these are all the different kinds of relationships that this organization has. And therefore, whatever is the personal data of the people that you all are interacting with, data protection is to be. How that needs to be done, I'll cover in a while. But this is important to understand that the personal data of all the people that you interact with. I'll give one example. Suppose you are interacting with a government department or a local authority. Then at least you have the name, email ID, contact mobile number, contact phone number of that person. And that is the personal data. Of course, you can always make a statement that there was a legitimate interest between the two organizations and therefore this person remained the representative. All said and done, it's all fine, but still that person's personal data needs to be protected at this organization. And vice versa. If the person interacting from this side is interacting with any other body, they need to ensure that the personal data of this person is protected. Any questions on this? Thank you. Now, what are the different steps for becoming GDPR compliant? Okay. One, define the roles, controller, processor, and data protection officer. Okay. Now, controller is the person. The controller is an organization, but within the organization, you should have a designated person who is securely managing the personal data, be it paper form, be it electronic. Okay, so, but that should be a defined person or a team of people. Okay. Likewise, processor can be a person or a group of people who will be processing the data. It could be internal to the organization or it can be external to the organization. The next is data protection. I have covered that in between details and business process review. This is important part. You need to establish the journey of the data. Where is it originating? And then where is it finally ending? Or where it is being stored? I'll cover that also in a minute. Design and execute consent form. At least this one step you have already started taking from today. So please continue doing that. Then define, amend the privacy statement and terms and conditions. If you have not done it, that needs to be done. Okay. Then, whatever legal contracts that you may have with any organization, please get them reviewed for the GDPR compliance. Okay. Let's move on. Any questions on this? I have covered this consent in greater detail, but these are different examples given. You can see the boxes unticked, which you can see on the form as well, that you already have. On the mobile phone, if you are doing anything, then you will see this box here, which is unticked, which means it is asking you for the consent. And if you are giving any email marketing consent kind of things, then again you will see the unticked box. This was not happening before. Those all the boxes used to be ticked on the phone. Now this is quite important from the data journey, or where the data needs to be protected. Okay? So the data needs to be protected at a user level, then at the business application level. Okay? Next is at the database level, and finally at the cloud level. Now, user level. One form is your paper-based form being submitted. Okay? So that's a user level. Now, I need to ensure that when this form is being submitted, nobody else is taking a photograph of this. If a person is taking photographs, it means there is a breach. Already taking place without consent of anyone. Okay? So, this is one way. Second way, when you access any website, please ensure that the website address has HTTPS. If you see any website that is just HTTP, which means it is not secure. The S in HTTPS stands for secure. S stands for secure. What that means is anything that you're typing there, it is encrypted. And what that means is, suppose I am writing my name is RAM, between R and A, it will be garbage characters inserted. But when it is read at the other end, then those garbage characters go off and only RAM appears. So that's the simplest form of understanding the encryption. But whenever you have the S at the end of HTTP, that is a secured website. If you are using Office 365, then every email that you send is encrypted at the source. Before it, as soon as it leaves your computer, it is encrypted. So nobody can read it when it is being transmitted to the other end. Okay. So first step is at the user level, and this needs to be done by means of having the policies in place, both for physical and IT. So that's an action point for the organization if it's not in place. Business application. Any business application that you may have, they're using emails. That's a business application. Okay. You may be using accounting software. That's a business application. Organizations use customer relationship management software. That's a business application. So any business application, there needs to be adequate protection. Databases is the core where the whole data is being designed and maintained. That needs to be protected. And finally, wherever the final data is being stored. These days, most of the organizations are using cloud. So in the cloud, wherever, whatever form you are saving it, but that there should be adequate security for the data protection of the data. And this is the different processes that you need to follow through. You need to focus on the security and protection of the personal data throughout the data journey of the data subject. That's the first step. The second step is, in order to establish data journey and understand points of potential data leakage, it is important to review business processes. An organization may provide business process documentation to be reviewed for GDPR compliance, and GDPR, we can help you with that. So these are all the different steps that you need to take in order for becoming GDPR compliant. Now, activities to be completed. So you should begin with the gap analysis, okay, and prepare a report as to what are the areas that you need to address for GDPR compliance. Then implement those changes to be made, churning to be conducted, and the contract reviews to be done. Now, what are the activities to be done at your end? Consent form given to you, you need to do it for all the people. And the simplest way is, whenever you have the church service here, you give it to people, ask them to complete it, but ask them not to repeat it if they come again. That's one way. The second way is use one of the online tools to send a link to people via email and ask them to give the consent, and the tool will pick up all the details of the people who have given the consent. We can help you with that. Then, and this is very effort intensive, then security policies to be in place, both physical and IT. The GDPR compliance for IT, you need the security, data remediation. This is very important, that you may have the data which might be quite old, and you should get rid of that if it's not required. Okay. Updated subscriber database with consent, evidence base that I just covered. Then you need to have some of the policies related to GDPR, privacy policy, I covered that, data retention policy, data deletion policy, data access policy, security policy, including IT. Now these are all the different actions that you need to take. These are different steps that you need to do. Educate senior management, which is currently happening, gap analysis, consent form, IT security, customer facing documents to be reviewed and make them GDPR compliant, employee training, sign up legal contracts, maintain risk register in case of data breach, what can happen, or what other security related risks you have, monitor them, and draw the GDPR roadmap to start the journey. Now, having said all this, suppose the organization decides not to be GDPR compliant, then what can happen? Okay? So this is the boardroom or the management committee of the spiritual organization like this. A lot of stress, isn't it? Okay? So this is a better subject. In case of beta breach, wow, what's going to happen to me? A lot of stress, isn't it? And this is at these two levels, but besides that, you have potential donation loss, isn't it? You have potential penalties, and also you have the potential reputational risk. People start losing trust, isn't it? So therefore, it is very, very important that the organizations follow all the 12 principles and be GDPR compliant. So that's all I wanted to cover as far as this is concerned. Before we go to the next step, I want to request all of you to download LinkedIn app on your phone, if you have the account. If you have, how many of you have LinkedIn account? Okay, if you have the LinkedIn account, I would request you to log into your phone, and I'll tell you why. I want to show you one simple technique which will take 2 minutes, and then you all can get connected with me straight away. Okay? If you're interested. Otherwise, it's fine. Or else, you have my contact details here. You have my contact details here, and you can connect with me. Okay, you have the presentation copy where also you have all my details. Mm-hmm. So that was everything from my side. If you have any questions, I'm here to answer.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
At this point, we'll go into question and answer. So, if there are any questions that you have and that you want Ram to answer. Thank you, sir.
There are two questions. They are quick ones. The first is the design of the consent form.
Yeah.
The consent form, you gave us a good example. But in this kind of our churches, most of us, it's normal to have the consent incorporated into a membership form, membership application form. So now that you've told us about the consent has to be unique, must not be part of another terms and condition, and it must be easily withdrawn if they want to. Are you now advising us, or will you clarify the position whereby a consent is already part of an application, membership application form, whether we can improve it by separating those two parts? That's number one, not a waste of time. Second part is that we will highly appreciate, because you've not mentioned anything about it, and it is an issue within the religious organization, the matter of CCTV and its implication with regards to GDPR.
I will.
Thank you.
Good. Both the questions are very interesting, and I'll tell you the practical aspects of it.
The first question.
Yes, sir.
I'll answer in two parts. One, the existing members.
Yes.
Okay. Now, for existing members, you can't ask them to re-register. Okay, for them, something of this kind. Okay. The second, new members. Application form that you have, you should add the first line of the boxes there at the bottom. That my preference to receive communication into bracket, please tick preference in box below. Should put those boxes. And after that, that should be signature.
Okay.
So by doing so, while completing the application, they are sharing their preferences with you about how they want to be communicated, and also they are signing it, which is an evidence-based consent.
Okay.
Okay. So that answers your first question. The second question, that's applicable not only for the gatherings here, but any person who is coming to your organization for a talk. In ideal terms, you should be taking the consent from both sides. Okay. Now, because you mentioned about that part, you should also have a separate consent form, or maybe in this you can add, they have no problem if their photographs are taken by means of a picture or by means of a video, and they have no problem that being published in any form by the organization. Okay, that's one. And in future, when somebody is coming from outside, you should ask that person to sign a consent form giving you the authority to video record that person's whole view. For example, today this everything is being recorded. Okay. If I had wanted, from GDPR point of view, I would say,
no,
don't record.
Yes.
Okay? Not only now, but in future also I can say, you can't publish.
Yes.
Now, to protect the organization from this kind of problems or issues, the best thing is for a speaker to sign the consent. That they agree that the photographs will be taken, they will be used for the organization purpose, and if the videos are taken, then they will be published whatever form they are going to be. If it is YouTube, then you say YouTube, or any of the media that you are going to use it. But that is very important part.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, the organization can get into a trouble.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying will, but there's a possibility of foreign organization to get into it.
I want to answer for CCTV.
Yeah, you should have a signage for CCTV. You can get from Amazon or from anywhere. You can put that on the front. So then you like this CCTV.
When somebody is entering the building, entering the church building, they should see the signage in the front at multiple places, and before any of the services which are being video recorded or the photographs being taken or CCTV images being taken, should make an announcement. And if anybody has a concern, please let us know now before we start operation. 99.99% people will not say anything. But if you have taken this one action of just making an announcement, from GDPR point of view, you are safe. Any more questions, please?
We'll take just one more question, if there's any. And if not, I think we're pretty much covered. And we asked most of the questions during the lectures.
Thank you.
At this point in time, a round of applause, please, for Mr.
And thank you very much for giving the opportunity to me and to this.
At this point, I want to take this opportunity on behalf of the head of diocese, the deputy head of diocese, the UK diocese in general. I want to specially thank Mr. Ram Kudnani and Rizwan, because hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What we do not know is that today, really, they are celebrating their Indian Diwali.
Oh.
And he had to leave that just because he had given us his word and promised that he would be here.
Oh.
So he had to forfeit that. So we really appreciate you. We really appreciate you, and thanks very much for coming. I'm sure our relationship will be a lasting and fruitful one, in Jesus' name. At this point, we thank the HOD as well for attending. And for me, it is a big thing, not just because HOD and Deputy HOD is here, but because they've had a very, very busy week, and they still made it a point of duty to be here. Please give them a round of applause. That is Aniwa Inti, sir. Ben Fumwa. He said, not a ten shade, a Nijer in India. Eti Berenada, a Paria, and a Rebecca. That is you that the Dabu Nibatin. It's a wonderful thing that the diocese is doing now. At least we can confidently say the diocese is looking after our interests now. Because the diocese, in the past, it's always a case of diocese come go wo on come bury it, not come bury it, but once double for what? A year, she saw more by sin. To the diocese is a kidney, on see the performer. Hallelujah, round of applause for the diocese. Daju, only to 20 rule, to the pay, and that to 21. Hallelujah. We're rounding up now. The future plans of the Education and Training Steering Committee is something that we all already know, and that we already know, because this is just preparing us for the future. Where we're going is that in the UK, there will be a Celestial Church of Christ UK Diocese Seminary. I'm not sure you heard me, because if you did, you were here. Hallelujah. And that seminary is going to mirror exactly what we have in Nigeria. So the days of I'm running to Nigeria to go and do crash program, those days are gone. Hallelujah. And the days of, they don't know what they are doing, we don't know, those days are gone. Because now the seminary is going to be put in place, and we will all have the benefits of going through it. For those of us who are shepherds already, and for upcoming church workers, the Lord God will continue to be with us.
Amen.
There will also be a training, compliance training in Manchester next week, Saturday, on the 26th of October. Because, yes, it is going to be the same one, because what it is, we don't want people outside London to feel like they have been sidelined. So what we're doing next week is not just GDPR. Next week, it will be health and safety, safety and fire management in churches, safeguarding, and GDPR. All three lecturers will be there in Manchester to give the lectures, and I pray that the Lord God will continue to be with us. And I can confidently tell you that our fathers who have been supporting us, this is about, in fact, I think I can confidently say, this is about the first time Dallas is my royal, this year, talking about Druti. Talking about Druti. Whatever you need to fulfill what we have given you, he just fulfills the scripture that says, when God sends you on an errand, he will equip you. And what the diocese is doing is equipping the committee so that we can achieve their vision. But we are just the instruments that they are using to accomplish this vision. And the Lord God will continue to be with us. So please, we thank you all for coming. No. Safeguarding and fire and safety have been done in August in London already. If you look at the flyer says in GDPR in London. GDPR only in London and the other three. But if you are willing to go to Manchester to do the other courses, there is a van. You don't have to pay for transport. We will take you there and we'll bring you back. Free of charge. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, yes, sir. Yes, if you need, of course, we will feed you. We will feed you when you come to Manchester. If you look at it now, the money you're paying for your certificate is just a token. Because it's a whole year already. Hallelujah. So the Lord God will continue to be with us. Thank you all for coming. The Lord God will bless you. And we pray that. And also, before I round up, two things. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let me just tell you, if you notice, the certificates that you have been given, those certificates are important. Because I tell you this, and I tell you confidently, that a time will come, and that time is very, very near, where for you to have access to certain positions or privileges in the church, you will need to provide these certificates. A time will come where to be a shepherd, to be a church worker, or to do certain, to play certain roles in the church, you will need certain qualifications. And at such times, these certificates will come in very handy. And that is why we have made sure that the people who sign the certificates are certified and authorized to do so. Because it is that signature that authenticates the paper. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So please make sure that you get your certificate before you go. And
how long does this last? A year or forever?
Once you have got it,
subject to review.
It's subject to review, but
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me answer that question, sir. For as long as the legislation remains as it is, then it is valid. But we know that we live in a society that is subject to change. So if anything changes, then just as it is at work, when you have certain for qualification, sometimes you have to go for refresher courses. You have to update yourself with regulations. So that is what would happen. And also, I've been giving. Oh, yeah,
accept our thanks in Jesus' name. Our Lord and our God, you said wisdom is the principal thing. And in all our getting, we should get understanding. This we are fulfilling so that we can be compliant with the environment that we are in. The little that we have done today, Father, bless it for us.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
This is just the beginning, Lord. We've handed everything over to you. And we know that you are in control. The good work that you have started in this diocese, Father, complete it and perfect it in Jesus. Lord, we thank you once again for all our elders, our fathers in the Lord who have turned up today. Reward their labor in Jesus' name.
Amen.
For every one of us here today, Father, do not forget us.
Amen.
We thank you also for the gentlemen who have joined us today as consultants. We pray that because they have entered into Celestial Church of Christ, the blessing, the special blessings of Celestial will be with them.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Glory, honor, and majesty be unto you. Amen. Amen.
The Lord's name. Opportunity given to us in order to acquire sound education and to create awareness, also understanding and wisdom in our life. Father, give them unto us.
Amen.
All we have learned today, O Lord Jehovah, don't allow it to leave us.
Amen.
As we shall go to our various destination, O Lord, guide us.
Amen.
Be with us.
Amen.
Let us all go home with abundant blessing.
Amen.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Shall we shout seven hallelujah to give glory to God?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.